Innately, children seem to have little true realistic anxiety. They will run along the brink of water, climb on the windowsill, play with sharp objects and with fire. In short, do everything that is bound to damage them and to worry those in charge of them. That is wholly the result of education, for they cannot be allowed to make instructive experiences themselves. What a wonderful quote by Dr. Freud. But despite this childish behavior, they too have a thinking, a perspective about everything happening around. They too have a psychology, what we refer to as child psychology. Recent advances in several branches of psychology, including the development of children and relationship, point to the various factors influencing the child's behavior in a positive manner for them, their family, and for society as a whole. Tackling the question, what is child psychology, is a very large venture of which we can only make an outline here. So, to talk on this subject, we have with us an eminent educationist and psychologist, Professor A.G. Madhosh. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Amit.
Sir, as you are aware of today's topic, we are talking about child psychology. So, to begin with, just tell us something about what actually this child psychology is.
Thank you very much, Sanna, for projecting me as an eminent psychologist and educationist, and thereby, you know, increasing my responsibility for both the subjects. Now I come to your question, what is a child psychology? You see, actually, it is a way of understanding children's behavior. But then, in a technical, professional form, we look at child psychology looking at the human design in its earlier or smaller forms. So you would like to understand human design. You see, if you have a child here, then what he does means how he behaves, why he does it, and in what ways he does. So the child behavior that is available in families, child behavior that is available in schools, child behavior that is available in society as large is a kind of focus for child psychology. And of course, once we see it's a focus of child psychology, and naturally we will be looking not only from the point of view of understanding child behavior, but we do have some strategic corrective mechanism and operations in our mind while we look at it. Because at certain occasions, we find that why do we need a child psychologist as such? Mm-hmm. Or why do we at all need a separate division in psychology that is devoted to child psychology? So, as the father of child psychology, Dr. Sigmund Freud, mm-hmm. whose beautiful quote you began with, would say that, of course, it is actually the child who should be focused or concentrated upon. If you want a very bright, a very brilliant, achievable, accessible, child, and productive adolescence, then look at the child. Mm-hmm. So understand the child, understand his preliminary, elementary needs, mm-hmm. and set a direction. And if you can play a role in understanding child and then finding out a way how to tackle the child behavior when it is in its just innocent forms, as we say. So therefore, whether you talk of motivation, mm-hmm. you talk of learning and then learning skills, or you talk of language, or you talk of number of impacts, effects, influences, you see, whether it comes from direct family members, that is parental influences, or friendship influences, mm-hmm. or peer group influences, or relatives influences, or how does he educate himself, or how is learning possible, how the process of learning goes, whether it is a formal kind of learning in education, mm-hmm. or it is informal learning process in within the family. Mm-hmm. So wherever you look at, you actually are concentrating or focusing on a child. Now, a very important thing that you would also actually try to understand is the periodic growth, that is physical or biodevelopment, yes, of the child. So all such things, whether it is biological development, it is psychological development, or it is his social development, all these forms of development make a focus or concentration or the point you are attending in child psychology.
So tell us something about the stages of a child psychology. What stages does it go through?
Let me not talk about stages in child psychology as such. Let us talk about stages of growth and
In a
development of
child.
the child. Because the point is, we are actually talking this time on child as such. So once you start talking, you will see that as conventionally we go with infancy. So you have infancy between 0 to 3, then you have childhood 3 to 6, then you have boy or girlhood up to 12, and then you have adolescence, then you have adulthood, then old age. You see, different stages of development. But as I did talk earlier, you see, you are having infancy 0 to 3, then 3 to 6. If you take these 6 years into consideration, then you'll find that the blueprint of personality of a person would be formed, formulated, determined in these 6 years. I would say, if you keep personality on one side, say, then tell me what is personality. Say, personality is function of first 6 years of development. And what goes on in development process during these 6 years is very important. Because one say, I put it in a functional relationship of maturation on one side and then the experience on another. But what is it that makes child's experience? The child's experience is made firstly in his own home, and the idea starts with whether the child has the realization, has the sensation, has the understanding in a very rudimentary form, maybe in a very small minor form, that is, whether he is acceptable to the world or not, whether this world is worth living or not. We have a very wonderful theory by Erik Erikson, who talks of this kind of, you see, the child, where you are cuddling the child, you are bathing the child, you are feeding the child, all these processes of nourishment to the child give him an idea that he is not being only washed, you are communicating, disseminating, transferring a lot of love to him. And once he has the feel of that love, he says, yes, this world is worth living. I am acceptable to the world.
So, as you said, so like we know the child is first born to a family. His first school is the family.
Okay.
What impact does the family have on the child psychology?
Is the whole impact? You see, you start with family, and in family you start with mother, or the immediate caretaker. You see, here mothering is a relative concept. It's not always important or necessary that it is gender specific kind of thing. It's not gender specific. Even a father can be a mother for the child. Because what is important is mothering technique, mothering. So from the source, that mothering technique goes to the child, is the mother for the child. So immediate caretaker is mother, and mother, her influences on child. Her influences first, whether there is a very strong, lovable, handsome rapport between mother and child. Generally we find, yes, there is a rapport. That is, the mother would always love a child unconditionally. There is an unconditional positive regard for child. So, rapport is there. Therefore, you are talking about the influences. The child learns as he grows that there are some people whom we would call sociologically as significant others. Your mother is there, father is there. If there are some other people around, they are significant other. So their behavior would directly influence the child's behavior. Is that the motivational power? Because you know that child is a complete, you know, package by God. So he has a dynamo. He has a force to drive himself. But that driving force would be influenced by the mother, by father, by the social environment in the family. I would talk about most precise, you know, impact that immediately at age 2 comes is that of development of language.
So true.
You see, if the child is thrown into a forest, he would not develop language
at
all. Language is a social function. And what type of language a child would speak
would depend on
the quality of language that is available in the home. So if you want a child whose language is such a communicative thing, not that he communicates, you enjoy his
communication.
That depends upon how he is being influenced within the home. and the home as an influencing agency even would set a direction for his schooling later.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, preschool condition is completely available or can be made available in a home itself. So that once a transition takes place from home to school, it is most comfortable. He goes to the school, he doesn't find anything new there.
Mm-hmm.
Because something that he has started in his home, he thinks that not only it is continuing, but it is actually reaching some perfection.
Is this heredity factor somewhere involved in psychology? Say, if a father and a mother has this particular kind of a psychology, is it necessary or is it not that a child has the same kind of psychology?
Sana, this is what generally people think, yes. I was repeatedly asked this question, you see. Is it that if a child happens to be very aggressive, if a child happens to be very shy, does it mean that
parents are aggressive?
Actually he has gotten it from his parents? But I tell you that by this date, we don't have any such studies available
mm-hmm.
in which psychological behavior is said, that is aggression, submission, love, etc., runs through blood. I would talk about, yes, there are physical characteristics of a child which are conducted and conditioned and by one's
hereditary.
There too again we have heredity interacting with environment, and sometimes you find a child who represents his parent or his parents more, you know, so far as the physical features are concerned, his height, his weight or his complexion, etc., then you would say it is H mold inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
That is where heredity has taken more place as compared to environment. So yes, but for psychology, reflections, for thinking, for wisdom, you don't have any sure ground to say that it generally is inherited.
So what about the status of a child in the family? Say if a child is the eldest in the family, does it affect his psychology? And if he's youngest,
definitely
does it
Yes, obviously yes. You see, if you have, now there are a number of children, so first child has, that is the status, the entire attention goes to first child. In the beginning,
mm-hmm.
the whole attention. There are lots of chances, as people say, that since you are taking a very close care of this child, who is coming first in the family, naturally, sometimes what happens that he takes things for granted. He is so liberal with, you know, situation around that no one is there to discipline the child. Even if we find, even today I say that disciplining a child sometimes is not that, you know, in a way corrective measure. But then the first child gets a lot of liberty around, lot of freedom around, and sometimes people would even have a complaint against this kind of
mm-hmm.
freedom. And in the same manner, if the child happens to be the last, he also becomes a concentration point. So the status, one, first child, second child, third, last, whatever, that way. Not only that, even the status of the child gender-wise, whether it is a girl or it is a boy, whether girl would be accepted in our family or not. You take, you associate liability with girls, you associate asset with boy.
Mm-hmm.
You say boy is an asset, girl is a liability. That way again, that gives a kind of understanding of the status of the child. So, this idea that the question you put was, so I think this is a well taken up question in which we find, do the status matter for the behavior of the
child?
Yes, I would say yes. Then girl learns to adopt a role of girl,
yeah.
a woman's role, you see, and boy, then boy gets the role of a man.
True.
That means that the whole behavioral formation depends upon the status in terms of gender. Yes.
Now we have families from different economic and educational background. Do they reflect somewhere in the child psychology?
Yes. You see, there are studies in which you find that children coming from higher socioeconomic status, children coming from lower socioeconomic status, once you take their achievements into consideration, we find there are significant differences. If child comes from an educated background or uneducated, illiterate background, again there are differences. But then I tell you one very important point, because maybe people who just see our program as such, they may say that no, we have found situations in which people who did not belong to high strata, you know,
they are
whose people, whose parents were totally completely illiterate, how excellent they have become, you see. Then I talk of another thing which has been researched, investigated, what we call an achievement. There are some people, I mean children, whose need for achievement happens to be high biologically, you see. Therefore, they, even if they belong to any kind of environment, they would definitely be gifted later. So these gifted children, that giftedness is in a way born, that is with you, and therefore that exceptional case would not actually shadow your generalization. So generalization is this, that yes, people from high socioeconomic status and people from educated backgrounds would definitely try to achieve more as compared to those people who do not unfortunately belong to such backgrounds.
Now sometimes we find partiality on the part of parents as well. They treat the children partially. Maybe a boy child is treated better than a girl child. Where does this affect the child psychology?
It affects a lot. You see, that's why you say that a girl would not, you not see girl demanding in the situation as compared to a boy. That's why she knows that her things would not be accepted. She knows that she is more disciplined by, you know, parents as compared to the boy. She would say that her freedom is more restricted as compared to the boy. She's not allowed to talk as she goes on talking, you see. She would not be. So the parents would immediately think themselves as custodians of morality for girl. But they would be very liberal with boys. Then what happens with their behavior? Yes, they are very shy. They are not able to, once she goes to the school, one who is suppressed at home, she goes to the school. In school, she is not going to talk to people. She is not easily making friends, you see. Even friends are being suspected. So number of things you have, yeah, because of this gender variation and a different kind of treatment at the hands of the parents, yes, child would have a kind of behavior which perhaps will not help her adjust properly in society.
The family environment is very much controlled and determined by the relationship between the father and the mother.
Quite true.
Now, there are families where you have broken relationships.
Yeah.
What about such children?
This is a scenario in which we find children belonging to broken families. If we take from achievement point of view, we find that they are not doing well. Not only that, personality wise, they are the people whose stress levels are higher as compared to normal people who come from normal houses, where such complaints are not available. So once your mind is full of anxiety, stress, learning will not take place. See, learning is a function of comfort, you see, at least normal comfort, average kind of comfort that you should get. And when you are anxious, you see, you will not learn. So naturally, results are not as acceptable to society or even to school, you know, authorities as in normal cases. Not only that, even those children belonging to broken homes where divorces have taken place or constant fight between husband and wife is taking place, those children start getting or acquiring kind of threat and fear in their lives, which is the dominant kind of thing. Whether my parents are now calm today, if they are calm, I have a moment of enjoyment and I can laugh now. You'll find that no, that is not a possibility. Even whatever is the type of comfort you give within the home, if the home is not good in terms of psychological relationships as you are talking about, then it would definitely have an adverse effect on the children's behavior.
After the age of two and a half, the child is sent to school.
Yeah.
What about the environment there? How does it affect the child's psychology?
You see, now you have, it's a different situation now altogether. What happens, there are people, I mean children, once they are admitted to a school at 2.5 or 3, one is that you find children who are just crying, not ready to go to school. Then you find children who are calm and who enjoy. If you find these two types of things, then you try to understand them what has happened. In one case, that is crying, what we technically call is separation protest.
Mm-hmm.
It is a situation of separation protest. That she is being separated from mother, and mother's environment was more comfortable than the school environment. Therefore, this separation, and how long this separation is, that also would determine the crying behavior of the child or not comfortable behavior of the child. So if distance is between 6 to 8 hours, it can be more, or if it is less, it is less. So you have what type of environment have you provided to the child at home?
Mm.
If you separate him from that environment, he would definitely feel a deficiency, and with that deficiency he goes to school. Now in a school, if the schoolers understand this kind of transition of a child from home to school, then that case they provide them a kind of situation there which is not a scholastically or scholarly framed situation.
Mm-hmm.
It is a playful situation in which now children feel free to talk, feel free to do anything they like, only under your charge, that you are in charge of the whole thing. I mean atmosphere, not of child. That atmosphere or the environment you have built in which children feel it's completely enjoyable. I'm not away from school. I'm home. So that can be declined, and that you and instances are there. In such crashes and in such schools where preschool arrangements have been done, on the understanding of child psychology as such, of course, children there, you will not find them crying.
Today we have a trend because we have working parents everywhere. After the child is born, he is sent to the crèche.
Yeah.
Does it have any negative effect in the development of child psychology?
No, it will not have negative. But what is negative about it is that whether those working parents have moments of pleasure to seek the company of children. That is very important. You see, crèche is made that way that it will not give any sense of displeasure to the child. It is an enjoyable thing. But then what should be more enjoyable? The at least association between parents and child should strengthen. And if it does not strengthen, it weakens day by day, then of course that is negative.
Now we talk about children,
yeah,
in which we include the boy child and the girl child.
Yeah.
Is the family supposed to have a different attitude towards a girl child and a boy child for the positive development?
You see, that would be criminal if you have an attitude, I mean mindset, that girl is to be made, you know, or is to be prepared, or should take up the skills which are meant for a particular profession or particular avenue in life, and boy for this. That would be criminal. What you do is, you have to see whether what is the actually given characteristic features of the child. Means you go by the talent, you go by the merit that is with the child as such, and sit out harnessing. You have to take into account maybe that girls and boys many a times on cognitive streams. You see, once you talk of intellectual development of children, you find in many ways they compare well, comfortably well, that is girl and boy. But then if you have you are meeting out a different kind of treatment to these two, you are playing a part in which you are not developing the person or personality of the child, but you are influencing in a very negative and devastating manner. So what is important is look into the personality data, see the strengths of the child, see the weaknesses of the child, see if you can develop the strengths of the child, see if you can eradicate or remove some of the weaknesses
mm-hmm.
of the child. Do a lot of counseling as a parent and find that you can help children grow. Don't have a kind of treatment policy which sets these two things aside because of your mindset, not because of what they possess.
So we talked about family environment and the environment at school.
Yeah.
But does biological condition also have an impact on the child psychology?
Oh, yes, very large effect, you see. As I said earlier, that most important component of human design happens to be this biological side.
Mm-hmm.
So if biological side happens to be weak with respect to a child, so naturally you will find that there is a difference in behavior also. So like for instance, you take a biochemistry or biochemical functioning of a child or a human body,
mm-hmm.
you find that if you concentrate on glands or glandular functioning, you start with your thyroid gland,
mm-hmm.
and down to adrenal or pituitary gland, you will find that lots of hormones are being secreted in the bullock directly, and they are responsible for activating a kind of behavior which would tell you a story of excess or a smallness of secretion. So if that happens regularly in the behavior of children, of course their behavior would be shadowed or colored or even determined by biological conditioning. And you see, for any kind of action, I am talking this time, you see, you have to presume it that his you know, system, that his vocal cord, etc., which is engaged in, you know, talking, is all right. If it is not all right, I can't talk.
Mm-hmm.
So talking in itself, what I talk is psychological, but how do I talk is bio. So if you mm-hmm. see things, you see, seeing has two components. One, that you are using your eyes
mm-hmm.
in seeing things, but what you see is not within the biosystem. You see, that is psychologically ordained. Therefore, each component of your behavior is biopsychological, and in most of the times, biopsycho and social, you know, composition.
What is the role of parents? What role do they play in the success and the failure of the child?
Yes, you see, you have the people who have studied, you know, different types of parental influences on children. They have found that you can categorize them into four sections, or four categories, or four types. Like you have, first of all, you have a smothering mother type
mm-hmm.
environment. Smothering mother type environment is one where mother concentrates, or the child caretaker concentrates on the sharpnesses of the characteristic features of children. Therefore, they smoothen them. They discipline them that this, you should not develop your own individuality at all. You have to succumb to some conventional norm.
Mm-hmm.
That is smoothering mother.
True.
One is, you know, zookeeper mother. Zookeeper mother is that she has read number of you know, books on psychology, Gerseld scheme. She has talked to me, she has talked to wonderful people in psychology, how to feed the child, how to time the child, how to plan the child. She goes by that plan. She is not allowing the child to be with himself,
mm-hmm.
even to be with mother.
True.
She is zookeeper mother. And then you have another, that is overwhelmed mother.
True.
Where she is herself very anxious. She has all the anxieties in the world, and therefore she thinks that if someone else could be there who could take care of my child instead of me. And then there is super mother concept. That is, super mother concept is a democratic mother, a mother who is authoritative in views but is not authoritarian as such. Well, she is not having a dictate for the child, but she always breeds a sense of responsibility into the child in a lovesome, handsome, in a beautiful manner. So the child takes that this mother is one who is not mother only, not caretaker only,
mm-hmm.
but a friend in whom you can repose your trust.
So it was a wonderful discussion, and we have still so many aspects to talk about, but because of shortage of time, we need to conclude the program.
Oh.
I'd like to thank you for sparing your precious moments and providing us so much information. So viewers, today we talked about different dimensions and aspects of child psychology. We talked about various factors affecting the child's psychology and indeed provided you with some parenting tips. With that, we end our today's program. Till next time, take good care of yourself and goodbye.